So we have learned spectroscopy, we have learned imaging, which yesterday I understand was pretty hard to look at the phase of the NMR signal, that angle by which the transverse magnetization rotates precesses in the magnetic field. And we could modulate that angle by which it precesses with magnetic field gradients. That's actually with additional fields that we turn on and off, which have a constant gradient. And the way we turn those gradient fields on and off inscribes if we can measure displacement. Moving spins can measure their velocity, can measure their acceleration, or can measure their positions where they are in the sample. And that is the principle of NMR imaging, to know where they are in the sample. And today we will look at, we will actually also make use of encoding the displacement, the motion of spins, but primarily we are concerned not with coherent flow of molecules flowing through a pipe, but of molecules diffusing at random. So that process is called diffusion. It's a thermally driven process. And we will look at this, but we will also look at relaxation times, T1 and T2, and we'll try to understand what they can tell us about material properties. So today we will do materials testing. And we will analyze and see where that is used, and you will find there are many uses for that type of magnetic resonance. So let's first go back to the story again and look how we measure relaxation times. And there are two ways to measure the longitudinal relaxation time. It is the saturation and the inversion recovery methods. We had these earlier, so this is a repeat. And it's good to remember that there are two measures. One is we start from zero magnetization and then observe how the longitudinal magnetization, that is the magnetization that's built up in thermodynamic equilibrium, put the sample into the magnet, we wait for some time, the magnetization builds up, and then we can start measuring. Now we can repeat that process by just taking a 90-degree pulse, a series of 90-degree pulses, like 5 of these pulses, repeat them, saturate the magnetization, there is no magnetization left over. We wait for a time T0, the magnetization builds up, and we measure the transverse magnetization. By measuring the transverse magnetization, we learn how much longitudinal magnetization is there after the time T2. And that gives us the build-up. We can do the same thing by just inverting the equilibrium magnetization, observing that build-up and interrogating after some time T0 how much that magnetization is there. That gives us, this is a typical build-up curve of water in travertine stone. Now, travertine stone, if you don't know what stone it is, it's just a stone that has many little pores and is saturated with water. The pores are filled with water. So what you see is the water from the pores in the stone. Now, all the pores have different sizes, so there's a pore size distribution. And that actually gives rise to a relaxation time distribution. We will see shortly why and how. Now, that relaxation time distribution we can find if we fit this build-up function with a sum of many theoretical build-up functions and get the distribution of relaxation time T1. So now this is not mono-exponential like shown here, but it's many exponential functions that give rise to the build-up. And each of these relaxation times actually is proportional to a pore size in the rock. So from this we get the distribution of pore sizes, and we see that there are three characteristic relaxation times, that is, there are three characteristic pore sizes in the rock. Now, we can do a similar thing by measuring transverse relaxation, for example, with the Hahn echo, and then we have to repeat. If we do the Hahn echo, we have to measure with many echo times. That is the time between the first pulse and the observation of the echo, is the echo time. Or we measure a train of echoes in the CTMG echo train, and then we get, again, a decay of the signal, which is a sum of many decays. We do an operation that's equivalent to the inverse Laplace transformation and find out how often or with how many different decays there are with different relaxation times T2, and what the amplitude of those decays is. And again, we see we have a distribution of relaxation time, and that again measures the force function. So we find there are two, maybe three, probably here is a better resolution, three different force sizes in that rock cut. That's information we can measure from, or we can obtain from simple relaxation measurements of porous media. So the study of porous media is very important. In fact, the total signal amplitude tells us how much water is in the pores of the medium. So we have a rock that is only partially wet. We get the saturation of the rock, how much water is in it. If the rock is fully saturated, then we get the porosity of the rock from the NMR. And if we integrate, let's say, the signal intensity under one of these peaks, we know how much water is in small pores and how much water is in larger pores. And that actually turns out to be very valuable. Suppose it's not water, but oil. The oil from the large pores you can retrieve and sell. You get money for it. The oil from the small pores you cannot retrieve because it's caught in there. You cannot get it out. And the money is lost. So by looking at these curves, you can figure out how much money can you earn when you have an oil well. That, of course, is very important. Okay. So let's look at molecules sitting in a pore. Here's a pore in the rock, and it shows us it's not a circular pore. It has some arbitrary shape. It connects to other pores, smaller and larger ones. And here's one molecule, how it diffuses at random and moves through the pore driven by its thermal motion. And now we are asking, what is the transverse relaxation time, what is the longitudinal relaxation time, and what is the diffusion force? Now, let's start with the longitudinal relaxation time. That's this expression, that's the relaxation rate. It's the relaxation rate of the molecules if they were free without confinement. So you take just the fluid, and you look for the relaxation time or relaxation rate of the molecule in the fluid. That is 1 over T1 bound. But then there's another term, that's the surface of the pore. What is the surface of the pore? And the volume of the total pore. It's the surface to volume ratio. Now if you take sphere, the surface to volume ratio is proportional to 1 over the radius of the sphere, or the diameter, or the pore size. So the surface to volume ratio is a number that tells you something about the size of the pore. And we find that there's an additional relaxation which comes from the surface of the pores. Whenever a molecule hits the surface, it loses some magnetization. So there's an additional magnetization loss by the contact of the molecules with the pore. And that actually is the signature that we get in porous media. This term very often dominates, that one can be can be discarded or can be neglected, and then we know that T1 is actually, T1 is proportional to the ratio or to the radius or the diameter of the pore. And this is something that's exploited, so that tells us that the distribution of relaxation rate, relaxation times T1 gives us the distribution of pore radii or of pore size. That is very valuable information for people that study porous media. Now, if we look at the transverse relaxation time, we find similar expressions. There's a different surface relaxivity, which tells us that the contact with the wall has a different effect on the transverse relaxation. But otherwise, it's similar, that the transverse relaxation, this is rather small, that is rather big. The transverse relaxation time then is proportional to the surface to volume ratio, or the inverse of it, that is the diameter of the pore. But here's an additional term. And the additional term contains the self-diffusion coefficient. It has to do with the Brownian motion of the molecules in the liquid. But it also contains a term that is G, the gradient. And you know we had gradients before. Yesterday we had gradients. We needed gradients to measure energy. And in fact, we used magnetic fields that we applied, and they had a gradient, a constant gradient across. You know, remember that problem with the linear gradient and the constant gradient? the mistake that some people make. Famous people, big mistakes. Linear gradient, no, we use constant gradients. Okay? And so here appears again a gradient, but it doesn't say which gradient. It could be a gradient that's applied, or a gradient from the magnetic field that we use in order to measure. But it can also be the gradient that's inherent to the pore, even if you put the your sample in a homogeneous magnetic field. Why would there be a magnetic field gradient in the pore? Because the magnetic susceptibility, the magnetic properties of the rock matrix is different from the magnetic properties of the pore space or the fluid in the pore. So you have the magnetic field penetrates differently through the two different media, and that gives rise to an inhomogeneous magnetic field inside the pore. And that gradient, the internal gradient, we say, is proportional to the strength of the magnetic field. So if you measure porous media in your expensive superconducting magnet, which you are proud to have gotten money for, and measure high-resolution spectra, protein analysis, everything, you get very bad results, because you get internal gradients and you don't know how big they are. And you cannot measure transverse relaxation times easily. So what you really want to have, you want to have low magnetic fields. You want to have magnetic fields of the size which you can easily generate with permanent magnets. And actually, this type of NMR to measure relaxation time, study porous media, is the beginning, or one of the beginnings, of NMR with permanent magnets, and of NMR with magnets that can be carried along to where you want to measure it. For example, to the oil well, where you then do your measurements inside the oil well. I'll show that in a second. Get rid of this one here. Okay. So there is that diffusion term. But you also see there appears the echo time in here. So and it actually is squared, the echo time is squared. So if you measure with a CPMG sequence, the short echo time, which means short separation between the 180 degree pulses, then you can make that term very small. But you can only make it small given, you know, it's scaled up with a field gradient. And the field gradient in high field can be something like 10 tesla per meter, which is excessive. It's much, much bigger than what people use in medical imaging. They use field gradients that are much smaller, which they generate with coils and turn on and off. But here it's always there. So that at high field cannot be made to, or let's say cannot be made vanishingly small by choosing a short echo time. Okay. And now lastly, we have the self-diffusion coefficient. We have a self-diffusion coefficient in bulk, which means you only take water or you only take oil. You look at one molecule, and it's not the oil or the fluid does not sit in the pore. It can freely diffuse. And the distance it moves depends on the square of the time it has. So the more time it has, the further it can diffuse. It helps to have Lego software. So it depends on it scales with the square of the time it has to diffuse. So the with time, with the square root of time, the molecules diffuse further and further away from their origin on the average. But when you have a pore, then at some diffusion time the molecules will hit the pore wall and they cannot diffuse further because they're confined in the pore. So they have to diffuse back. So it means the apparent diffusion coefficient measured by the distance traveled in a certain time appears to be smaller because the molecules cannot diffuse as far away. And that is this ratio here. This is the apparent diffusion coefficient of the molecules diffusing in here. They hit the wall, they go back. And this is the diffusion coefficient of the free fluid. Now that ratio, again, is pretty persistent today. That ratio of the diffusion coefficient depends again on the surface to volume ratio. So again, if you measure the restricted diffusion in a pore, you get information about the surface to volume ratio, about the pore size. That actually the the inverse of this, d0 over d, for long diffusion times is called the tortuosity. That's the resistance of a porous medium with connected pores to the diffusion of molecules through all the different pores that are connected. It's a term that is very important for porous media. Now let's see how we measure diffusion. We want to measure diffusion, and the classic pulse sequence uses the 90-degree pulse, and you generate a gradient echo with two great magnetic field gradient pulses, the same ones you've seen yesterday. An antiphase pulse field gradient pair. Terrible word. But it means one gradient pulse is negative, the other one is positive. And what it... I need somebody who kicks this away all the time here. Oops. There we go. Is that what I had? Oh, here I am. Okay. We do the following. We look at the molecules now in our pore. We apply a magnetic field. This is the offset field in the rotating frame. And it has a gradient, because this is the gradient of the magnetic field, which, you know, where we only say we pulse the gradient. We actually mean we apply a magnetic field that in the beginning has a gradient which is negative. That's the field gradient. This is a magnetic field in the rotating frame. And at this time, we apply a magnetic field with a positive gradient. So it shows up this way. So the magnetic field, it points down in the rotating frame, increasing with position in the x direction. And here, it increases with position in the y direction, pointing up. And that field can be written, the gradient, the magnetic field is the gradient times the position. That's, you know, how the how you work out the field. When you have the gradient, and we know that we can write it as a phase. And let me now write it on the board what the phase is. The phase we know is phase phi equals omega times t, we can write that as gamma magnetic field times t, so omega equals gamma times B is the fundamental equation that you all should know, which I've used right here. And then I can write the B as gradient times, what do I have, X times, and now the time delta is the time that the gradient is active, and this time I call delta. So I have a phase for each time I apply a gradient. And now I apply a gradient twice. The first time, phi 1 is gamma minus gamma g times, how do we call it, g0 times x times delta. And g0 is just the gradient value here. So it's negative with an amplitude g0. And the second time, I apply it to equals plus gamma g0. X times delta. So I use the same gradient, but I use a positive sign. And now I'm asking, what is the total phase? And the total phase of the signal I get in the end is phi equals phi 1 plus phi 2. So I have to see that people on the camera can also see that. And that is then given as phi 2 is gamma d 0 phi, I have to use that is the position 1, that is position 2. So the spins are at the different instances in time, they are at a different position. You see here it's at position x1, there it is at position x2. So that the molecules have moved. So I have to use these indices, and gamma g0 delta, and then I have x2 minus x1 in here. Okay, so there's a minus sign, x1, plus sign, x2, the rest is the same. And that, this function here is actually our k, our wave number, which we had yesterday. So it's k times x2 minus x1, and x2 minus 1 is exactly the distance that the molecules have traveled in between the two gradient pulses at the time delta. So the distance traveled by the time delta would give velocity, but now we have diffusion. Velocity doesn't make sense to specify for molecules that that move at random. And the classical notation is then that, as used by Callahan and Karger and other giants in the field, we call that Q times X2 minus X1. And Q is the Fourier conjugate variable to displacement. Yesterday, we defined Q as the Fourier conjugate variable to velocity. And velocity is just displacement over time. So our other Q would be we just have to multiply times delta over delta. And then we could also write, for yesterday's nomenclature, that the phi for velocity would be U over V times X2 minus X1. Q times delta over X2 minus X1 over delta. And that is our QV, which we had yesterday, times velocity. So yesterday we had a different vector or wave number Q. This is supposed to be a Q, not a 9. My handwriting is bad. That's a Q, okay? This is yesterday's Q for velocity. Today we have a different definition of Q that we call this value K equals Q. So there is some for diffusion. That is coherent flow. So what we need to do is vary. If we want to measure diffusion, we have to vary the gradient G in various through various steps. And we do that by either changing the area under this pulse and measuring several times, or we can vary also the time delta in order to measure, get a signal attenuation that then scales, allows us to measure diffusion. The amount of water, yes, that's just the signal amplitude. The amount of water is simply the value of your CPMG decay at the beginning of your measurement. And the amount of water gives you the water saturation, how much water is in there. And if it's fully saturated, it gives you the porosity of the porous medium. And the amounts of water in different pores you get by integration of the different peaks. Okay. So now there are different ways of measuring diffusion. I don't want to go too much into detail. We have just seen it. You can have the Hahn echo sequence here. This is the Hahn echo. Here you see the free induction decay, the echo. And you apply these field gradient pulses. Now actually you have a positive one and then two positive ones because there's this 180 degree pulse in the middle. Remember yesterday we went through the argumentation that the 180 degree pulse changes the history. It makes it inverts the sign of the gradient pulses. So it's sort of rewriting history for everything that has happened before the pulse. It changes the sign. And this is why that pulse now is actually positively applied, because the effective gradient then is negative. And you see that effect of the effective gradient here. If we use a CPMG sequence in a constant gradient, and each 180 degree pulse inverts the sign. There we are. Inverts the sign of the gradient. So we apply that gradient, but the effective gradient actually means it's negative here. It changes the sign where the 180 degree pulse is, and it changes its sign again where this 180 degree pulse is. So it means we have a negative effective gradient here, a positive one here, a positive one there, a negative one here. And so that's that sign change that comes in. But these are, let's say, the measurement schemes that we always need two gradient pulses to measure displacement. And from the displacement, from the distance the molecules have traveled and the time they have traveled, we can calculate the diffusion coefficient. Okay. Let us just focus on the right-hand side. Now there is a stimulated echo sequence and a constant gradient. And this is a typical sequence that people use for well-logging NMR. And here you see the effective gradient. It is only active when we have transverse magnetization in this interval and in this interval. And then by varying either the time between the two, the second and the third 90-degree pulse, or the echo time, that is this time and the time until the echo is there. You see echo time over 2, echo time over 2. Either we vary delta or we vary the echo time. And with that, then we can measure diffusion coefficients. A typical decay by varying that looks like this. It can be inverted then again by an inverse Laplace transformation into a distribution of diffusion coefficients. And for the same travertine rock filled with water, we get this type of distribution of diffusion coefficient. So at least there are two pore sizes, one with a small diffusion coefficient, confined pores, small pores, the molecules cannot go very far, diffusion coefficient is low, and one with larger pores where the diffusion, apparent diffusion coefficient is higher. In both cases, we have restricted diffusion in the pores. So that's the theory behind it. So I hope you learned that with pulsed field gradients or constant gradients, you can measure diffusion. And there is a contribution of internal magnetic field gradients. That's why we want to use low magnetic fields to have the internal magnetic field gradients low. And this is why people use permanent magnets. And here are some ideas, you know, what permanent magnets look like for different applications of relaxometry and diffusometry. For measuring relaxation times and diffusion coefficients. You don't need the big superconducting magnets. You can work with cheap instruments. So everything I tell today, the applications we will have in the following, can be measured with inexpensive equipment, which is very simple to operate once you know how to measure T1, T2, and diffusion. There's not much to it. Of course, for you at the moment, it's a lot because everything is compressed into a few minutes. But when you keep busy with it for a while, it's not difficult anymore. Here is Jasper Jackson. I met him. He is the inventor of well-logging NMR. A very interesting person, a brilliant physicist. He has done many different things. And I remember that he even was one of the people. You remember when they tested the atom bomb after World War II, right afterwards? There were pictures of people sitting in armchairs and looking how the bomb explosion goes off, and you see that a terrible explosion coming up. He was one of them sitting in an armchair and watching the first explosion. So he was busy in many things, and among others, he had the idea of building a magnet that he can lower into a borehole. You see, these are the gray things, are the borehole wall of an oil well, and these are permanent magnets, and you lower them down to measure NMR signal from a region that is this ring. And this ring sits actually in the borehole wall and is the sensitive region from which the NMR signal is collected. So you can measure the NMR signal in the rock surrounding the borehole wall. Very clever idea to have that array of magnetic fields. Well, this is the, you know, a sort of similar version that we have come up with in Aachen. It's the NMR mouse. Again, something where the measured, the region where the signal comes from is outside the magnet. And it can be placed into an object you put on top. And that is called NMR Mouse, Mobile Universal Surface Explorer. And so we call that, thus, this type of measurement stray field NMR, because the object sits outside the magnet in the stray field, and the stray field is usually inhomogeneous and has a gradient. So now we have magnets that have a constant gradient, and you need a gradient to measure diffusion. But you can also measure relaxation in a gradient field because it doesn't matter for relaxation if there's a gradient. You don't need a homogeneous magnetic field. You would need a homogeneous field for spectroscopy. But today we are not interested in spectroscopy. We just measure relaxation and diffusion. And there are other magnets where the sample sits more or less inside, and that's the classical C-shaped geometry. There's more sophisticated ones. This is something that is called the Halbach magnet, where we actually arrange magnets with polarizations that trace the loops of a dipolar field. Here is a dipole inside, so it's a relatively homogeneous magnet. You can build that magnet probably for something like $20. So it's a very cheap magnet you can build. And all you need then is the NMR spectrometer. And actually, NMR, the low-field NMR has two origins. One is in well logging, I'll show you. And the other one is in food analysis. And people used in 1973, Bruker came up with magnets of this type or this type that produce relatively inhomogeneous fields to measure relaxation and diffusion in food, in emulsion. Salad dressing, for instance, or milk is an emulsion. Water and oil. Oil droplets dispersed in a water, in a continuous water phase. And you can learn from these measurements the droplet size distribution. What is the distribution of drop sizes in there? The same thing happens with skin cream. Skin cream is an emulsion of water and oil. Or is it oil and water? I don't know which way it is around. Pardon? Is water in oil? Yes. That's what I thought. So it's water in oil, and you want to know the droplet size distribution of the water. And the smaller the water droplets are, the deeper the skin cream can go into your skin. And that's technology. It's simply a way of mixing water and oil if you get skin cream that goes deep in your skin or not. And one has to figure out, is it good or bad when it goes deep into your skin? Most people think it's good. But, of course, the skin is there so that you don't dry out. You don't want to lose the water inside your body when you're out in the sun. So there's a barrier for penetration. And the other way around, also when you go and swim, also you don't want the water from the lake to get into your body. So there's a protection. And if you penetrate the skin barrier, you may get very sick, you know, if that happens. So there's a good reason not to penetrate it. And it's a matter of the cosmetics industry to find the right formulations and of the state to watch that they are being observed. Let's start with well-logging NMR for our applications. And here is three generations of well-logging tools. And there's the NMR sensor. This is called wireline logging. In the olden days, people didn't use a permanent magnet in there. They said, we use the Earth magnetic field. And we only take a radio frequency coil and some electronics and measure the signal. The problem is the signal comes from the fluid in the borehole, which is the oil and the drilling fluid. So that's, but you, they really wanted to know what is the signal from the borehole wall, because it tells us about the restricted diffusion. It tells us about the surface relaxivity, the pore size distribution, which you want to know in order to figure out can you get a lot of oil from the well or not. And then Jasper Jackson came with the idea and says, let us use permanent magnets, and then we can really measure into the borehole wall. And that was a breakthrough. That was a revolution in magnetic resonance. And that is called wireline logging. You have the tool that you push down to the lower levels where the oil sits. That will be in red here. And then you move it up slowly and measure as a function of position where you are. You measure the relaxation time distribution. You'll see this, how they look like in a few slides down. Here you see a company in China, which we're allowed to visit, that produces these tools. The long pipe. All the electronics are in there, the magnets are in there, and that's an NMR spectrometer here. An NMR spectrometer that you can put into the hole of an oil well and then measure the surrounding fluid, relaxation. And then recently, maybe 10 years ago, people started to develop a logging while drilling tool. So here's a drill head, and there's the NMR spectrometer, very close to it, next to it. It is so robust that the drilling, the shaking from the drilling does not disturb the operation of the tool. That's amazing technology, I think. And now it allows you not to build holes, just drill holes just straight down, but go in all kinds of directions. That is called directional drilling. And there are various analytical tools in the drill string from which then the people on the platform learn in which direction they should move the drill to get maximum oil recovery. That's today's technology. So we have one platform and many holes going away in different directions from the platform to recover the oil. Here's Bob Kleinberg, and explaining the inventor, or he constructed the first commercial logging tool. at Schlumberger, and he explains one of these logs. You will see a magnification of that chart pretty soon, a few slides down. Now, just a little a slide maybe for those technically interested how these tools look like. They're different designs. This is the magnet. It is basically a cylinder like this one, and it is polarized this way. So the magnetization of the magnet goes transverse. And then you wind a coil around it, which produces a B1 field orthogonal to the B0 field. And the theory then tells us you can measure signal from a circular shell around it, which surrounds the sits in the complete borehole wall. So you get very high volume, which you need because you have low magnetic fields. You need many spins to measure it. And the other idea that Bob Kleinberg has followed, you build, you know, have magnets over here. You press the sensor in the borehole, that's the borehole, against the wall, and then measure from, a region of relatively homogeneous field, which is called a sweet spot. You measure only signal from that region. And that's this is the Halliburton tool, and that's the Schlumberger tool for the oil people. They have two ways of doing it, and it's competition among the oil companies which want to use. Now let's look at the signal from a porous rock. Here's a porous rock, and I have indicated various ways of water. There is clay-bound water. That is water that is bound to clay and cannot be retrieved. There is capillary-bound water, which is water that sits in capillaries which have no connection to the outside. And there is water which wets the pores of the rock. Most rocks are water-wetting. That is, the walls are always covered with water. And the oil then sits inside the water-covered walls of the rock. So the gray part is the water, and then when the pores are connected, you can retrieve it. You can press it out. This is a decay of a fluid in a rock, and that is the relaxation time distribution which you get by inverse Laplace transformation. Now, there are the two peaks, and the oil industry actually defines a T2 cutoff at, I think, 20 milliseconds. That's right here. And they say integrate everything in the T2 distribution to the right, and that is a fluid you can retrieve from the rock, which you can move out. And the peak to the left is the fluid that sits in the small pores, which is bound and cannot be retrieved by applying a pressure gradient. So this is the amount of fluid which you can sell, and the oil you can produce from an oil well. This is the oil that, or the water that stays in there. But you still don't know, is it oil or water what you measure? So that's difficult. And for that to measure, one needs more sophisticated measurement tools, which we come to after the break. Okay. So there are a couple of quantities, and I will not go through all of them, which are important. The very first thing to notice when people measure in the oil industry is the rock is always fluid saturated because of high pressure, and you're certainly, 10 kilometers down, you're in some, there's always some fluid, mostly water for the oil industry, sometimes oil, or it could also be gas, or actually oil with methane in there called life oil, which then has very special relaxation properties, but I will not address them in detail. Actually, you have them in your slides if you'd like to look at them, but I will skip them in the lecture today. The important message here is from the total signal amplitude, and you can measure the porosity. This is the porosity or the signal amplitude by NMR calibrated against the porosity in the lab measured by buoyancy methods. So you do a laboratory measurement, you determine porosity by other means, and you calibrate it versus NMR signal amplitude, and you find you have a pretty nice correlation that tells us that NMR really measures porosity in a porous medium. Now, I want to show also the relationship to the pore size distribution. This is a a relaxation time distribution of water in limestone. And then you can measure if you have a porous medium. You can also determine the pore size distribution by pressing mercury in. It is called mercury intrusion porosimetry. It's a standard method. But mercury, of course, is not a very healthy substance to handle, and it's a relatively dirty business, but it is a standard method, and if you do mercury intrusion porosimetry, you get the derivative of the capillary pressure curve that gives you the pore size distribution. That's standard technology. This is what people do to measure pore size distributions, and you test catalyst porous, heterogeneous porous catalysts this way and get the pore size distribution. So you get a pore size distribution for capillary pressure, mercury intrusion porosimetry, and you get the curve by NMR and the NMR relaxation curve. And what people then do, you just shift them so that the peaks show maximum overlap. And from that shift, you have the NMR T2 scale and you have the porosimetry radius scale. Actually, the porosimetry gives you the throat size distribution, how the pores are connected, the throats that connect the pores. And NMR really gives you the pore sizes. There's a slight difference. But you get a beautiful match, and the match between both gives us what we call before the surface relaxivity, which is a property of the rock. And you can measure that with classical homogeneous magnets like the Halbach magnets, and then the impact of the external field gradient is low or zero. But if you take the NMR mouse or a stray field sensor, which may have a very strong field gradient, you have additional signal attenuation from diffusion. Remember, the signal decay, the transverse magnetization, depends on T2 and the self-diffusion coefficient. Now, I said that usually comes from the internal gradient. But when you apply an external gradient, because your magnetic field is inhomogeneous, you get additional signal attenuation from diffusion, which has the effect that you measure the blue curve instead of the red curve. But the blue curve still looks very much similar to the red one, except it's compressed. So you don't lose any information. So you can still get the pore size distribution also from these other instruments. Okay, and this is the last slide. That's when we will stop for the take a break and ask the questions. I show you two relaxation time distributions of two different rocks, one with a permeability of 0.4 millidalton, one with a permeability of 9.34 millidalton. What is permeability? Permeability is the ability of the rock to transport fluid through it when you apply a pressure gradient. How big is the flow of fluid through the rock when you apply a pressure gradient? That tells you how much pressure do I have to apply. Do I get the fluid out easy? Then I have high permeability. Or is it difficult? Then I have low permeability. Now, the porosity of the rocks are 8% and 11%, so they're not very different. But here the permeability is low, here it is high. And you see for the low permeability rock, the lower peak is high, and for the high permeability rock, the higher peak is high. The high peak tells us we have the fluid sits largely in large pores. And for the low permeability rock, the fluid sits largely in small pores. And the small pores are more difficult to connect, so it's more difficult to push the water out of the small pores, so permeability is low. So it tells us also from these curves we can predict permeability. And there are models in the oil industry that take these curves and derive models to predict what is the permeability, and that tells the engineers how to get the oil out of the rock. And that's a very crucial quantity. It's very important and involves, the more accurately you can do it, the more money you can save in getting oil. And that this is true is actually shown in that curve over here. We started with some rock, Pietra di Noto was it called. It's some rock from Italy. And you see water in large pores, water in small pores, and then we dry the rock. And you see where the signal goes away? It goes away from the large pores, but it largely stays inside the small pores. So the signal in the small pores doesn't change in the drying process, so it changes only little, but the signal in the large pores is removed. So that tells us this is producible fluid, or that is producible fluid, and this is bound. We will stop here, take a break. We do another set of applications in the second part. And if you have questions, ask them now or in the break. I'm always there to answer questions. Yes, please. Yes.
T1 refers to the longitudinal magnetization.
Longitudinal magnetization does not involve a precession, only the transverse magnetization. So it cannot affect the phase of the NMR signal, and so it is not affected by the gradient, which always acts on the phase of the NMR signal. Longitudinal magnetization doesn't have a phase. And that's why it is immune to a gradient. Yes. Yes, I mean, essentially, a gyromagnetic ratio means the higher or the lower it is, then your NMR frequency shifts to higher and lower magnetic fields, and it means that T1 and T2, in fact, strongly depend on the magnetic field strength. That is an equivalent sort of answer to your question. The gyromagnetic ratio, or the field strength in a way, or the NMR frequency at which you measure your relaxation really impacts or is a parameter which on which the relaxation times depend. And there are actually machines, field cyclic NMR, that measure the relaxation times as a function of the NMR frequency of the applied magnetic field. And one finds that at low magnetic fields, the difference in relaxation times between different materials is usually bigger than in high fields. So low fields are good to work out, you know, discriminate, distinguish different materials in terms of relaxation. Very good question. Yes, 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 they all do. For the gradient. Yeah. But there gamma comes in just in terms of the gradient. The bigger impact if you change the total NMR frequency. I mean, the gradient is to be, let's say it's 1 tesla per meter. And your sample is 5 millimeters. So that's a smaller impact. The bigger impact is really the absolute value of gamma when it enters into the Lama frequency. Then you can go from frequencies of let's say kilohertz up to a gigahertz. You know, you go through 6 orders of magnitude. So this is a much bigger range that you can. So field cycling experiments don't go that far, but the total range of frequencies that can be interrogated by NMR goes from 0 to 1 gigahertz, which is a much bigger range than what just the impact of the gradient field. You looked at the gamma in the gradient field. And that's a small perturbation of the applied magnetic field. Other questions? That's a very good question. Don't be shy. Any question is good, you know. Other people probably have even, you know, they think about something, should I ask, should I not? Just ask. No question is stupid. There is no stupid question. It can be a stupid answer by me, but not a stupid question. Yes.
Yes.
What does this mean? The relaxation modes. Are there spin
also? Well, I mean, we're looking at the fluid in a rock, right? A rock is porous. It has pores. We don't look at granite that has very little
marble, right? The pores are very small. You don't get any fluid in. We don't get any NMR signal. We're looking at the proton NMR signals, that the protons come from water, from oil, or from methane, gas. So we have to get that into the rock. So the rock needs to be porous. And the porous rocks of interest are those that contain water and oil. You know, you have, actually there are, I've seen in Pakistan, I've seen a lovely water filter which was a porous rock. You pour the water on the top and you collect it from the bottom. It's a water filter to clean water, and you use the porosity of the rock. And in the and the oil sits in also in the pores of the rock, and in fact, the fracking industry is there in order to increase the pores in the rocks to put in cracks so that you can release the oil and the gas that sits in the small pores. So they are all porous, and the relaxation properties in the pore are different from the relaxation properties of the fluid in bulk when it sits outside and is in a big container. And that difference is exploited to learn about the pore size, distribution, or, you know, by relaxation and by diffusion. I mean, that rather relates to the sensitivity of NMR, but it's typically, if you're at lower fields, you're less sensitive, and you're somewhere in the percent regime. And then, of course, you do signal averaging, you can move that maybe an order of magnitude down if you do long signal averaging. No, I don't think you get the age of the rock. You just get pores, pore sizes. It could be young rock, could be old rock. You don't learn because you're measuring the fluid inside the rock. You're not measuring the rock. So you're interrogating the rock indirectly. Age of the rock is geophysics. But, maybe there are some ways of looking at isotopes when you look at rare nuclei, quadrupolar nuclei, and you really have to study the signal from the rock. But that then wouldn't be proton anymore. Can we do? Yes.
We will see. At the moment, I've only shown you, you can measure the total signal amplitude gives the amount of fluid. Now you want to know how much is
oil. Is that your question? Yes.
Can you check the water level or the percentage of oil present in that particular area?
Yes.
When you go deeper, that content can increase.
Well, I mean, once you're in the at a certain depth, you're always fully fluid saturated, right? The barbell zone is in terms of, you know, that's the term from geophysics, is the zone where you're
full fluid saturation. That's where the plant grows, and you have the roots that take up the water, and from the partially saturated porous medium, which we call earth. And if you're at sufficient load, sufficient high depth, this is usually, I don't know how much, could be 10 meters or 100 meters, then you're fully fluid saturated. And that is, you know, that is sort of not a question then, at least for the oil industry. But there are, of course, a lot of studies of partially saturated fluids, in particular soil, plant growth, that concern that partial fluid saturation. And if you measure there, in fact, we have a project doing that with a logging tool, a small one, which we built. And that allows you from the signal amplitude to determine the moisture content, the fluid saturation in the soil surrounding that little tool, the signal amplitude. And then again, you can look at the relaxation time distribution and get some estimate of, you know, where the water sits, you know, in walls, in in the pores or in small pores, big pores, or in certain corners of pores, and you can figure that out for computer simulation. Other questions?
Yes, I mean, I'll show you. We look at two-dimensional experiments with distributions of relaxation times and diffusion coefficients, and from that you can identify a water peak and an oil peak, because the relaxation time distributions overlap of water and oil. But if you take diffusion as a parameter to separate them, then you can learn what is how much water, how much oil is there. That is a big big help, because only the oil unfortunately brings the money, and not the water. You would like to have clean water here, then that would be very relevant to know as well. Okay, now we go from water to tea.
relaxation time distributions of a fluid in a porous medium. And we see, where is it? Here is it. We see that for two types of porous media, you know, a rock with a low permeability, we have the fluid largely in the small pores, and for a rock with a high permeability, K is the permeability, the fluid sits in the larger pores. And so what people then do, they figure out models, how they can predict the permeability of certain rocks and rock formations from these relaxation time distributions. Now there are several theories and there are several models, and we will not learn all of them. But the result is that you have the permeability that's measured in the laboratory when you do apply a pressure gradient across your rock sample and you press the fluid through it. And this is the permeability you estimate from the relaxation time distribution of NMR. And you see that there's a pretty nice correlation. Depending on which model one uses, the Coates-Timur model is more accurate than the mean relaxation time model, for example. Actually, there's a funny story. I once was skiing in northern New York, and I was sitting on the ski lift next to a person, and he was the son of Mr. Coates. So I could discuss about the father's work, you know, on the ski lift. Very odd situation. Anyway, so that is what people do, and then here you see a well log that's measured when you lower one of these logging tools in the borehole, and then you move it up and measure relaxation time distributions while you move it up. So the relaxation time distributions you find here, they are in, where is it, track 4. So these are relaxation time distributions. For example, you see there is a lot of fluid in small pores. There is no fluid in small pores. There is fluid in small pores. And there is a lot of fluid in large pores. So it is quite clear that the permeability is high in these regions and is probably lower in these regions. So somewhere, track 3 right here, it says permeability, and you see it's low. In these regions, low permeability, high permeability, low permeability. So you can read that off. And this is these different tracks. There are several other tracks here. The what are the relaxation times in certain bins? That means in certain regions of the relaxation time distribution. And this here gives us the depth in feet. They have masked the most significant number, so one doesn't know where that was measured. But you can see it goes, no, I cannot see. 2,000, probably 150 feet, 200 feet, 250 feet, and then, you know, something in thousands in front of it. So from these logs, then, this is what the NMR and some other tools produce. The geophysicist decide on how to operate the oil well. An oil well usually is not just one hole, even in the olden days. It's several holes, and you can pressurize them at certain places. They develop a model for the oil well, and this is the data they use to develop the model, and then how to set the pressures to retrieve the oil. Enough oil well. Now let's go to other materials. Let's go away from porous rock. Let's go to other materials. And I first want to generalize the concept of two-dimensional NMR. We learned two-dimensional NMR when we discussed NMR spectroscopy. We had COSY, we had NOSY, we had exchange spectroscopy, heteronuclear correlation spectroscopy, all these things. And now we go back to that scheme. The only difference is that now the detection time, when we actually measure the signal, all these are preparations of the initial signal that which we start measuring in the detection time. That detection doesn't have to be a free induction decay, which we Fourier transform into a spectrum. It can be a multi-echo sequence, just a train of echoes where we get the decay signal. We know that this we can invert to a distribution of relaxation times by the inverse Laplace transformation. And then we get these peaks that tell us this is bound fluid and this is producible fluid. And we can do all kinds of encodings and mixings and preparation before and increment certain parameters to do two-dimensional Laplace NMR. Now that's a really interesting concept because it's ingenious. It's something that happened in the last 15 years. That two-dimensional Fourier NMR was complemented by two-dimensional Laplace NMR for materials testing. And this is a really interesting development which has enlarged the use of NMR considerably. And here we see some examples. Of course, we have pulse sequences again. So they're kind of hard to read, but not really. That's just a saturation recovery sequence for T1. So this is a saturation sequence of five pulses. Then you do the interrogation pulse that generates transverse magnetic. Oh, no. Then you have a T1 time, which is the evolution of longitudinal magnetization. Here you suppress it, you kill the longitudinal magnetization. Here it rebuilds, and then you interrogate it with a CPMG sequence. And you just measure. So you have basically encode T1 in this period, and you encode T2. And as a result, when you do a two-dimensional Laplace transformation, you get a T1, T2 correlation map. So you have the distribution of relaxation times T1, the distribution of relaxation times T2. And you get some, distribution of signal in there, which is, I don't want to go into the analysis of that one, but I only want to say, you probably know that today the fracking industry becomes very important, that people look for the gas in the very small pores and they fracture rock underground and this way retrieve the gas. And in fact, the gas reservoirs in the world are much larger than the oil reservoirs. So there was enough petrol fuel in the ground for many hundred years. And the fracking industry also has shifted the whole balance. The United States used to be the biggest importer of oil, now the export oil, because they have so much from their own fracking. And that experiment is very useful in analyzing shale, which is the formation where one does the fracking to retrieve the gas. So for the fracking industry, this is an important experiment. Now, the experiment that we are interested in are those two. And this is an experiment over here that measures a stimulated echo followed by a CPMG train. Now, the stimulated echo, when you apply it in a constant gradient, is a way to measure diffusion. So the first part here, this, is something that allows us to measure the distribution of diffusion coefficients. And remember, there was diffusion is different, first of all, in large and small pores, it's different, because it's differently confined. But also the self-diffusion in oil and water is significantly different. I mean, oil has a lower self-diffusion coefficient than water. And this measures us the relaxation time distribution. If we look at the relaxation time distribution of oil and water, in fact, this is we measured for salad dressing, which is a mixture of oil and water, at least in my country where you use it. So oil and water, and you look at the relaxation time distribution, you see one peak, and you don't know if that is oil or water. Actually, it comes from both oil and water. But what you would like to know is how much oil is there, how much water is in there. So you do a second experiment, or you do a two-dimensional experiment that allows you to resolve that relaxation time distribution according to the distribution of diffusion coefficient. The diffusion coefficients in oil and water are significantly different. You get two peaks. You get one for water, and you get one for oil. And now you have two peaks, you can integrate the area, the peaks, and you know how much oil is in there, how many protons are there in the oil, and how much protons are in the water. And then before you get the volume or the concentrations, you have to convert the proton spin density to the number density or the molecular weight and do a little bit of conversion to calculate, actually to take care that water and oil have different spin densities as such. So that needs to be taken care of too. But this is a beautiful example how two-dimensional Laplace NMR can be applied to look at concentrations when you have an oil and water mixture. How much oil, how much water? Very nice experiment. I guess that answers the question that you asked me. Yeah. So, and there's another experiment that is a relaxation-relaxation exchange experiment. So you have a CPMG sequence here, you have a waiting time and another CPMG sequence. Why measure two CPMG sequences? Well, it's sort of like the COSY experiment where you measure the same proton spectrum in the indirect dimension and in the direct dimension. Now you measure the same relaxation time distribution in the indirect dimension and in the directly detected dimension. But in between, you leave a waiting time. So you identify by the peaks in here, and this is the, I don't know which to switch. This is, one is the evolution time, one is the detection time. So the distribution in during the detection after the waiting time, and this is measured, let's say, before the waiting time. So let's say before the waiting time, we have molecules sitting in large pores and molecules sitting in small pores. There should be a peak here. Can you see that? I can't see it from that angle, but here is a peak, here is another peak on the diagonal. And then you wait some time, and molecules can diffuse within the pores, but they also can move from a small pore to a large pore, or from a large pore to a small pore. And when they have been sitting in the large pore, they had a high T2 time, and then they move to a small pore, and then suddenly during the detection period, they have a small T2 time. So they have changed their relaxation times because they have been migrating from large to small pores or from small to large pores. And that gives rise to these exchange peaks, which I hope you can see. I can sort of guess that they are here from that angle. And that, again, is a very interesting experiment because that allows us to measure diffusion without even applying magnetic field gradients. Now, we know the self-diffusion coefficient. We can estimate the distance, the mean distance between large and small pores from the time it takes to travel, and that is the mixing time we allow it. We actually, to do an accurate analysis, one has to model this whole thing and to get the proper kinetic exchange numbers for the exchange rates between for molecules traveling between large and small pores. But it gives you very detailed information about pore connectivity, which then could be, again, related to permeability. How do you get the water or the fluid out of a rock? Or how do you dry a wet rock? Or how do you dry a powder? Let's say detergents for your laundry machine. How you do dry it? Do a classical drying experiment. You never get out all the water, but you get the mobile water out. But that would, you know, that analysis would tell you, allow you to estimate the drying kinetics and make models for that. Now, there are also mixed experiments where you can do a Fourier transformation in one dimension and a Laplace transformation in the other one. And a very powerful experiment, there you need, again, a magnet with a homogeneous field. So this is, you can do it low fields, but you need a homogeneous magnetic field. There's a little side discussion here. It is called DOSY, diffusion-ordered spectroscopy. Suppose you have a mixture of many molecules, large molecules, small molecules. You measure the NMR spectrum, the regular 1H proton NMR spectrum, and it is a superposition of all the spectra from the small molecules and the large molecules. So your spectrum is very messy. It is very hard to analyze. Now, what you could do, of course, you can put it into a GPC column. You can fractionate and sort according to large molecules and small molecules and measure the individual NMR spectra. But putting it to a GPC machine and your small concentrations is difficult. You can do a sort of fractionation in your NMR sample too by sorting the molecules according to their self-diffusion coefficient. The big fat molecules will diffuse slowly, and the small agile molecules will diffuse fast. So the big molecules have a low diffusion coefficient, the small molecules have a high diffusion coefficient. So if you resolve your NMR spectrum according to the distribution of diffusion coefficients, you get something that allows you, there's the chemical shift, here's the diffusion coefficient. You can separate the peaks that appear on the chemical shift scale as two peaks in a second dimension. And it's illustrated here for a very simple case. You measure NMR spectra, then encode them with diffusion, just do a stimulated echo sequence before with pulse field gradients, and that gives you a particular decay. And if one does a Laplace transformation around that dimension, along this dimension with the pulse field gradient, use just the gradient strength of the gradients that you apply. Then you get the diffusion. There is D, the diffusion coefficient in this dimension. And you see that water has a higher diffusion than acetone. And so the two spectra are separated. That's how, in principle, it works. If you do a practical example, here are two molecules, erythromycin, complicated big molecule, lidocaine, a small molecule. You look at the mixture of both. You see the sum spectrum of the mixture, which is the sum of this spectrum and this spectrum. And you want to disentangle them. So you do that type of experiment. You do one cross-section through here, gives you the spectrum of component one. And another one cross-section through there gives you the spectrum of component two. And then you have, with one diffusion coefficient, 0.62 times 10 to the minus 9 meters squared per second. That's the small diffusion coefficient. You get this spectrum. And for the higher diffusion coefficient, you get this spectrum. And that, of course, is the same spectrum as that from lidocaine, the small molecule, higher diffusion coefficient, larger molecule, smaller diffusion coefficient. Now, from the mixture, you have extracted that spectrum. It's a fractionation only because you have resolved it according to the self-diffusion coefficient. It's a beautiful experiment, very, very powerful, but, of course, only doable on high-field machines or machines, also low-field machines, that allow you to measure diffusion. So you need homogeneous fields. That's important.
But that ultimately shows the interaction between the two molecules.
No, it doesn't show any interaction between the molecules. The assumption is that the molecules diffuse independent of each other. So if you have intermolecular interactions like glycerol and water, then you see complex phenomena. But here the assumption is you have a mixture and each molecule diffuses within the mixture with its own self-diffusion coefficient and has in the given concentrations of the neighboring molecules. I mean, they impact the diffusion coefficient in the mixture. It's not the diffusion coefficient of the pure solution of that particular molecule. It's slightly different.
So we have to apply some pressure so that they can diffuse?
No. It's the thermal motion. It's a self-diffusion. It's not the pressure-driven diffusion where you have a concentration gradient. The only concentration gradient is there in terms of magnetization of the molecules.
So there may be another solvent by which they are separated, or by itself?
No, it's just like fish in the water. You know, you separate in a way the fish from the water. The fish swim by themselves, and the water molecules diffuse by themselves. So the fish have a slow diffusion or a different diffusion coefficient from the water. And that's what you exploit. You don't do anything to it. You just have it sit in the magnet.
Can correlate the diffusion of two molecules?
Of course, you can then make models and figure out why is the diffusion coefficient high or low, and then relate it to particular features of the tissue, for example, or examine or of a drug in a tablet or in a solution. Pardon? The drug release is best analyzed actually by imaging. You do imaging experiments as a function of time, and you look at a pill that how it dissolves, or you measure the NMR spectrum in the fluid and see how the concentration of the drug changes. This is not an experiment that's typically done in biology. It's an experiment that is done in the chemical analysis of mixtures. That's a standard application. Yeah? Okay. Now we go to a different application. We go to an application of stray field NMR, which again is a sensor similar to the well logging tool, except that it's not put into a hole, but it's put onto a surface, and it measures the signal from a sensitive volume. That's a little gray red bar over here, which sits outside the magnet, and this is where it measures the signal. So our example in this case is a wet wall. It's actually in an old church, so it's a Christian temple, let's say, and the wall is wet. It's 1,000 years old, and it's painted, so it's very precious, and they have a problem with the water in the wall because the water then comes out of the surface and destroys the painted wall. And people would like to know what is the water concentration in there. So usually your sensors that could be measure the, let's say, apply a voltage and measure the resistance, or apply an electric field and measure the dielectric relaxation. It will tell you how much water is in there. But the thing is, one always measures some integral water concentration in an undefined volume. So you measure into a certain depth. And what you can do with the NMR mouse, you can resolve the concentration of water in the wall. So the deeper you go into the wall, the higher will be the water concentration, because towards the surface, the water evaporates. It diffuses to the surface, evaporates. So near the surface, the water concentration is lower. So no other method is able to measure, resolve the depth profile so well as NMR does. And we see two water concentration profiles. There's depth into the wall. Zero is the surface, and then up to 14 millimeters into the wall. That's about that much. You go into the wall. And you see here the absolute concentration of water, the moisture content, the water saturation in the wall in terms of percent, volumetric percent. So there's 14, or what is it here, 5 volume percent of water at the depth of 13 millimeters in the wall. And these are absolute numbers. So you can really quantify. This is a very simple experiment. All one needs to do is you set up the NMR sensor over here. It sits on a sliding table, which allows you to move it back and forth. And this way you can sample. There we are. And in this way, you can get signal, NMR signal, from different positions inside the layers, different layers of the wall. And here's another part where you actually have a layer of the wall 12 millimeters thick of mortar, where there's a gap and the mortar isn't properly attached to the wall anymore. So you see that in terms of the water profile, it's very wet. And then it gets drier simply because there's a gap between the mortar and the wall. So the message is you get absolute water saturation, volumetric water saturation from the NMR signal. And that in a very simple way, just the signal amplitude, nothing more. CPMG train, first point of the CPMG train gives you signal amplitude. Okay, so that's one application. Another one now is emulsions and suspensions. And that, of course, is something that relates to the food industry. And here you see the Brooker mini spec. That is the current version that Brooker sells as a tabletop instrument for food analysis. Brooker has developed tabletop NMR for food analysis. That was a driving request from industry. It was Unilever, in fact, that wanted to have instruments to allow them to further develop different types of food. And then Brooker decided we can do by NMR relaxation and diffusion measurements, we can, you know, provide a lot of information. I show you two applications here, where one to emulsions, one to suspensions, where NMR is a method now required by law for the analysis. It's the standard reference method in analysis of food suspensions and food emulsions. So let's first look at an emulsion, and we look at yogurt dressing. In fact, it's a salad dressing with yogurt inside. At Italian dressing, at a sunflower oil. And we measure simply a signal decay that is governed by diffusion. So we have a stimulated echo sequence, a magnet. This is the magnet. There's the NMR electronics, and these are the electronics to apply pulsed field gradients, to do this antiphase pulsed field gradient pair, one gradient negative, the other gradient positive. These pulses need to be generated. They're done in this box. Okay, that's the electronics that does it. So they do this measurement and apply a stimulated echo sequence, and then you get different signal decays. Now, how do you get the droplet size distribution of these different dressings? You actually assume a logarithmic Gaussian distribution, which is very well fulfilled in most cases. You take the you model the signal decay with a logarithmic Gaussian distribution, and that basically has only the width of the distribution as a variant as a parameter. And extract it then, if you get the best fit, you extract the distribution from the fit. And these are the logarithmic Gaussian distributions that give the best fit. And they are compared for measuring with the Bruker mini-spec and for measuring with the NMR mouse. And you see the difference is very, very minor between taking the NMR mouse, that is a single-sided device, which you could actually take if you have a plastic bottle, shake the plastic bottle that your dressing is properly mixed, hold the NMR mouse next to it. You don't even need to open the bottle. You measure through the wall of the bottle, and you can get the droplet size distribution in the bottle. If you take the mini-spec, then you get better signal-to-noise ratio, but you have to open the bottle and you pour it inside a sample tube and then do your measurement. Either one is fine. Depends on what you need and how you want to do it. So here's a simple NMR mouse. It's only this big. That does the job for you. So the droplet size distribution is one of the parameters that can very conveniently be determined from emulsions. So an emulsion is two fluids and they're immiscible, so they phase separate. You have a continuous phase of one fluid and droplets of a second fluid suspended in the continuous phase. A suspension is a mixture of a liquid with solid particles. So again, you have a continuous phase, that's the liquid, and then you have the solid particles suspended in the liquid, and that's what we call a suspension. A paste is something similar to a suspension, except the continuous phase is much less. Think of toothpaste, think of sand with a little bit of water in there, that's a paste. And an interesting paste for the food industry is fat. And fat is a suspension of solid fat particles in liquid fat particles. And what is needed, or the industry likes to know, is what is the contents or the amount of solid fat particles in the liquid fat particles. It's called the solid fat content. Now, what one does is one measures basically a decay, signal decay. Here's the FID because the magnet is relatively homogeneous. You just do a single pulse and measure the signal decay. Or if you take the mouse with an inhomogeneous field, you measure a CPMG decay. So let's say it's a signal decay. And you see there are two components. There are fast decay and a slow decay. The fast decay is from the solid particles in the suspension. Because in the solid, you have the dipole-dipole interaction. The dipole-dipole interaction couples all protons to all other protons and gives rise to a rapid signal decay. In a liquid, the dipole-dipole interaction doesn't exist. It's averaged away from molecular motion. The signal decay is slow. So you see this part is from the solid and this part is from the liquid. So you can say if you record all of it, you can analyze by a decomposition, numerical decomposition, the solid fat content. The actual measurement is actually different. You measure at a detection time, only the amplitude of the signal, at a time of 20 milliseconds. And you see that the signal of the solid has decayed at 20 milliseconds. So you only measure the signal of the liquid component, so of the liquid fat. Now, how do you get the signal of the solid? Very simple. You take the fat, heat it up, make it all liquid, and then you measure the signal amplitude. And then you have the signal amplitude of solid plus liquid. Now, if the signal of the liquid and the signal of solid plus liquid, you can take the difference. You have the signal of the solid divided by the signal you divide it by the total signal, and then you have the solid fat content. Well, that's the whole strategy. Again, a very beautifully simple experiment. You cannot even do much wrong when you do it because it's just measuring two amplitudes. You're taking the difference and the ratio, you're done. And here's some melting curves. And again, we have compared it to the NMR mouse. My laser is giving in. And you see melting curves as you change. You plot the solid fat content as a function of temperature. You see at about 25 degrees or here 40 degrees, all the solid fat has molten and most fats of interest for the food industry, and the temperature at which one measures the liquid fat content is probably 60 or 80 degrees Celsius, so everything is molten at those temperatures. And you can see that the NMR mouse and the mini spec, they give very similar results. So again, you can measure solid fat content with a simple sensor that you apply to one side from an object where you want to measure it. Or non-destructively by measuring inside some bottle that you get from the food store, and actually you can even give it back to the food store afterwards because you haven't opened it. That's a very convenient way of doing it. Let's go to biological tissues. Let's look at skin and look at plants. Human skin. The skin of the hand, here, this part of the skin we look at, okay? So, of course, people like to take skin cream because then they feel better and the skin feels smooth and everything is great. The pharmaceutical industry, the cosmetic industry, makes a lot of money by selling skin cream, right? And the interesting thing is we have done many studies with skin cream, and you can see how much time does it take for the skin cream to go into the skin. And how much time does it take for the skin cream to disappear from the skin? These are timescales of 20 minutes. Now, it's a perfect business model because it means you have to apply skin cream several times a day. So you have to buy lots of skin cream. That's good money for the industry when you buy skin cream every time. And you can also test that. Of course, there's a skin cream that, you know, when people get older, get my age, and you want to look young again, you want to have smooth skin. And so you buy expensive skin cream because it says on the label that your skin will then have no wrinkles. It's all nonsense. You know, it doesn't work. You get older and you get older. That's it. But, of course, you can show. And how do you show? You have to get a very characteristic signature of the different skin layers. Now, skin is a multi-layered tissue. There are different layers, and I don't know them all by heart. But they have different relaxation properties. You can see them as you move into the skin with, let's say, the NMR mouse and measure a high-resolution depth profile. You can resolve the layers, and you find actually differences between skin in the face, skin on the hand, skin on the arm, and skin on the lower arm, skin between men and women, skin between people with different skin color. It's a tremendous wealth of information you can get and then explore it for all kinds of research. But I want to show you one example which is of current interest in our work today, which looks at the distribution of self-diffusion coefficients in the different layers of skin. And we find that to be the most significant signature of the state of the skin. And this is what you see here. These are two of my students, and that's their skin from the palm of the hand. Okay? One student probably takes a lot of skin cream every time. Good business for the industry. The other one doesn't. Bad business for the industry. And look at how different these two maps look like. So first of all, you see they're different. Now let's look what is the difference. We have here depth into the skin, 1 millimeter. 1 millimeter goes way beyond the skin, goes right into the tissue. And here is the distribution of self-diffusion coefficient. You see in the outer layer of the skin, yes, it's very dry, very low self-diffusion coefficient. You go a bit deeper, self-diffusion coefficient goes higher. Half a millimeter, you probably have two self-diffusion coefficients, one here and one over here. And then you go back to this one. Not so interesting. Look at this person. Two diffusion coefficients in the outer layer of the skin. Two here, three here, two here again, and then two there again, and they vary dramatically. So we don't know what is really diffusion. Is it water? Is it fat? Is it glycerol from the skin cream? What is diffusing? This is a current study going on, in fact, together with one of the cosmetics industries, to figure out what they mean. And if that can be used, A, to produce better skin cream, that say that lasts a little bit longer and maybe even has a positive effect. But also, it is of value if you want to administer drugs or medicamentation through the skin that penetrates the skin barrier and then through the skin is absorbed by the body. Or the healing of wounds when you form scars and you want to treat scars so they don't look so bad on the in the face, for example. So there's many applications, some being useful and some being of questionable use just for feeling better. So either way, it's a big industry and there's a big market for it, and you can see that NMR provides tremendously characteristic signatures, which still is a field of research to see how to read it. Let's go to other biological. Yes, please. Not yet. Yeah.
It may be harmful.
It may be. No, I mean this is healthy skin. It's not harmful. This is just regular skin. You could we could measure your hand. You know, probably we'd not need permission by the ethical commission, by the ethics committee, before we measure it. And then we can look at your signature and see how that compares to these two, for example. But you will find something like it looks probably similar or in between the two, and it is not harmful because I assume you're healthy and your skin is okay. So it's the regular state of the skin, but you can manipulate it by skin cream because it goes up to a certain level into your skin. And depending when you applied it, how often do you apply it, apply it regularly, three times a day, twice a day, or none at all, then that will have some type of effect on the state of your skin. It may also be how much water do you drink during the day? Do you drink a lot of tea? Do you drink a lot of coffee? Do you exercise a lot? All these things may affect the skin. And that we would like to understand. What is the effect of exercise? What is the effect of healthy food? What is the effect of malnutrition? We have one study that goes along with dialysis patients. So these are the people who don't have kidneys anymore. And their blood has to be washed and taken out, you know, bypassed through a filter, so you take out the contaminants. And we find that the skin has to do a lot with the amount of water in the body. So the skin reports if the dialysis works well, if the patient needs dialysis again. And that is actually a study that is really valuable, because people on the dialysis machines, they have a life expectancy of about 10 years. And, by going several times a week, two, three times a week to the dialysis machine and being connected to it for several hours. Many, many people do. So there's a lot of value in these skin studies. Did that answer your question? Okay. So let's look at plants. You see a tomato plant in a magnet. This is the magnet we built ourselves. And there's a radio frequency coil in here that allows us to measure the NMR signal of the stem of the tomato plant. And one of my students then put the tomato plant into an artificial greenhouse. He took sodium vapor light to irradiate it, which is intense light. So something you would get, let's say, in summer here, very high light stress on the plant. And then he measured the fluid transport in the stem as a function of the on and off periods of the light. What happens when the light is on? What happens when the light is off? And something that I found surprising, I didn't know, is when the light is off, there's lots of fluid in the stem, and when the light is on, here, there is little fluid in the stem. So that means the light is so intense that the plant shuts off, goes into a quiet state when there is lots of light, because otherwise it would burn. But it takes up the water and the nutrients at nighttime when there is little light coming up. So the plant grows at nighttime and not during the daytime, under intense light. It's different when you have weak light irradiation. So that's one thing. You learn about, you know, there's different parts, the leaf, the fruit, the stem, and you can see how that sort of oscillates with the light on and off periods. But you can do more. You can measure the relaxation time in the stem and then calculate the relaxation time distribution through the stem. And that will show you several peaks. And you have peaks at long relaxation times, at shorter ones, and at even shorter ones, three peaks, maybe four. And then you can assign these, given these cycles, measure on the maximum and the minimum, where the water is most likely to sit, in the particular compartments of the plant. Now, I'm not a biologist. I will not be able to explain you the function of the different compartments in the plant. Some of you probably are. They know this. I don't. But the peaks can be assigned, and in this way, You can learn about the functioning of the plant, about the growth of a plant, optimize crop yield by using proper irrigation, proper sunlight, proper fertilizers, and so on. So again, a study by nuclear magnetic resonance. It's non-invasive, non-destructive. The plant doesn't get killed. People have designed sensors now that you can have in greenhouses, even out in the field, and study plants that are out in the field by having a mobile instrument. Now let's go to another class of material, to rubber. And rubber is, of course, something for car tires or bicycle tires or bicycle tubes. And there's one interesting correlation that the this is a picture of what rubber looks like. We have large chain-like macromolecules, and they're cross-linked by sulfur. The cross-linking process is called vulcanization, because sulfur is found in volcanoes. And so we have this network, and what is the important property is how many of these cross-links are there per volume. That's the cross-link density. And you adjust that by the vulcanization process, which is a technical process in fabricating elastomers, cross-linked rubber. And one would like to know that. And it turns out that the relaxation time is proportional to cross-link density. That's the cross-link density. That's the relaxation time. And this has to do with the molecular mobility. The more cross-links you have, the weaker or the more confined is the motion of the chain segments between two crosslinks. So they can wobble less and less between the crosslinks if you have more and more crosslinks. So the motion is more and more confined when you have higher crosslink density. So T2, the relaxation time, goes down when you have high crosslink density because there's less motion. And you can also look at the... So this is the relaxation time of a CPM GDK. You can learn about crosslink density, or you learn about the signal amplitude. You can analyze the signal amplitude. If you have foamed rubber, like a mattress, for example, you want to know the foam density of the mattress. And you just have to measure the signal amplitude, and you get the density of the foam. One can also study the strain. What happens when you have a strained piece of rubber? Here's a strained rubber band. There's the NMR mouse. Magnetic field points in that direction. There's an orientation angle between the strain direction and the magnetic field. And now you can measure relaxation time as a function of the orientation angle. For an isotropic material, you expect a circle in polar coordinates. So this is this one, low strains. The higher the strain is, the more it's pulled apart, the more anisotropic becomes your relaxation rate. So this is shown by these curves that they are not circles anymore. It's very clear, anisotropic. And what is really amazing, that the smallest relaxation rate is exactly, where is it here, at the magic angle, which is the second Legendre polynomial, the emerald from solid state NMR, because relaxation is dominated by the dipole-dipole interaction. So it shows up here. And then you can study, you know, what happens in certain strain rates. We find things we can analyze in terms of an isotropic, anisotropic relaxation contribution. And you find very interesting phenomena that are reminiscent of phase transitions and relate to stress-induced crystallization, which you have in rubber. So for the polymer scientists, that's an intriguing field to study, but we will not go into this. That I will skip. And probably I should come to an end here. That's an image I have shown in the very first lecture. Here you see the NMR mouse. You see a car tire on top of it. And you can measure a depth profile into the car tire. This is the depth profile, surface of the car tire right there. You go inside, somewhere deeper inside, and you see the different rubber layers. That's the tire tread, where you have the grooves in here. That's the tire the base of the tread, where the grooves are gone. So this is where the full material is. Then you have a second rubber layer there. And then you go down, you have the overlay of the steel belt. So there's layers on the steel belt of different rubber layers, textiles, etc., that tell you about the construction of the tire. And it doesn't show up anymore. There you see on the top right, you see the tire and how it's made up of several layers, and you can see those layers in the depth profile. And moreover, you can measure at each point a CPM GDK, do the inverse Laplace transformation, get the distribution of relaxation times. Always the same procedure. Distribution of relaxation times, distribution of self-diffusion coefficients. You get the distribution of relaxation times. And from these peaks, again, you learn the about the properties of the rubber in this particular gap. And I should say that at least in one tire company, the tires are developed and optimized, and the tire product quality is optimized with this type of technology. And thousands of tires are tested every year with this type of technology with NMR relaxometry, but they do not use relaxation time distributions yet, so that's something where they can improve. And I should mention another application, which is actually diapers. The fluid uptake in diapers. You know, it's something very important, and the different diapers are needed in different parts of the world because people have different customs. In the Europe, North America, diapers are changed only every half day or something. And in China, they are changed every 3 hours, so the way of using diapers is different. So the fluid containment has to be different in China and in Europe. And diapers have to be designed in a different way. They are high-tech products of many different layers. The way that the water goes, passes through the layer, or the fluid passes through the layers, and the water is maintained and contained there, is analyzed by NMR. Because you can look into it non-destructively, non-invasively, and learn where the fluid sits. So here I have to stop. We have one more lecture that will be tomorrow, and that will be more entertaining. I will speak about the use of NMR to analyze objects of cultural heritage, old stuff. And it can be done non-destructively, as we do with the tires. So, and you will see some fun applications that are also a lot of fun for my students and myself. And after that will be the exam. And I've prepared 10 questions, which are hopefully very simple. So if you know the very, very basics, then it will be relatively straightforward to answer these questions. They're very short questions. They have very short answers that you can give, so you can do that in a couple minutes. Only 10 questions, and hopefully it's not too difficult for you. So thank you for attending, and now we can ask questions. Questions of the whole course, of today, whatever you like to ask. Yes?
More difficult to do by NMR because you look, I mean, all components contain protons, and we look at the proton signal. And the fundamental question that we were asked in earlier studies is, you have glycerol and water, these are the main components of skin cream. And they form a very tight complex, so the glycerol always sort of attaches to the water. And so they diffuse together. The question is, you know, do they at some point in time, does the glycerol diffuse faster than, deeper than the water?
Particular component.
Yes, and you could analyze it when you deuterate one of the components. So you label it completely, you replace all the protons by deuterons, by deuterium. And then you can see how much, what is the effect of one component, and then you do the opposite, deuterate the other one, see how the other component goes down. These experiments have not been done because they're quite expensive. But they can be done, and probably should be done. And we are actually doing something on skin models that relates to that, but just using D2O, which is relatively cheap.
So can we determine
that
what amount of the given component is able to permeate in different layers of these? Like there is epidermis, dermis, and different layers. So is it possible to determine that also?
Well, with that deuteration approach, you would be able to do that. But a priori, by just doing that measurement I've shown, you do not get that extra benefit. Then you have to engage into a study, as I say, you know, with deuterated compounds, and then you measure the skin profile after application of a skin cream that's partially deuterated with one or more compounds, and then you can see how far everything diffuses. then you get that separation. So that's an expensive study. You need a rich cosmetics company to support that. But it's doable. But it's open, so you can. You want to do that for a PhD, or somebody else wants to do that for a PhD, you need to find a sponsor, and it will be an interesting thesis. Other questions?
Sir, I have a question, not from the lectures.
Yes.
Beyond the lectures.
Yeah.
Since magnetic anisotropy,
yeah.
So we have discussed in benzene, we discussed that benzene in cylindrical shape like that.
Yeah.
Like that, but we don't discuss in that shape, that anisotropy, protons are shielded or de-shielded by it.
Because you have a ring current, which is not, which let's say is inside the hexagonal ring of the benzene, and any current in the ring produces a magnetic field, which is aligned, depending on the direction of the current, which is the larger component will be diamagnetic, so it will be opposite to the applied magnetic field. So the applied magnetic field goes this way. The larger component from inside the ring will point in the opposite direction. And that means that the magnetic field circulating around the side, so point up on the other side, and that allows you to figure out what is shielded. So the protons sit on the outside, so the magnetic field will be enhanced for the protons on the outside. I hope that is a right answer. It did relate to the lectures. Other questions? Don't be afraid to ask. Maybe afterwards when the camera's off. Okay, thank you.